in Japan, there are actually a lot of sort of, they have an aging population, and a lot of elderly are now being taken care of by robots, and it's becoming more so. And one of the issues that they're facing right now is that some of the elderly are getting attached to these robots, right? And so there's this whole debate about, you know, because they make the robots kind of cute and they do smiley faces. And so some of the elderly are, and they, you know, they have pet dogs and, you know, et cetera, et cetera. And that raises, so some people are saying that, you know, we really need to make sure that the robots are very different from humans, like so that people can recognize that they're just robots, don't get attached to them. But I think Hott's right that we're actually very easily fooled, right? And that it's very easy, like especially once these robots get very sophisticated, they can converse with you, et cetera, et cetera. You start to develop some, they want to be taken care of by one robot rather than another robot, et cetera, et cetera. That's very, you know, it becomes very human, very natural. And so we need to think about those implications for, you know, when we actually deploy robots into the real world for elderly care, et cetera, et cetera.
I mean, is it a bad thing necessarily if a person gets attached to a robot? I had stuffed animals when I was little. I've had, you know.
Yeah.
Is that a bad thing?
So I think that it's not so much a bad thing. Yeah. I actually think that I'm less worried about it. And part of the reason is that I think that the elderly, especially the elderly population, these they're in these aging homes, they don't have a lot of interactions with other people. And they're, it's you might think that, you know, if this can give them some sort of emotional comfort, that's a net positive thing. You might think that in addition to that, you shouldn't just have that. Like, they should also have more human interactions, et cetera, et cetera, so that they can have, you know, sort of human relationships as well, like more people visiting them and things like that. But if these robots can help them in that way, I think that that's a net positive thing.
Mm-hmm. So I start to wonder if it's fair to the robots.
Yeah. Right. Yeah.
Jessica, does this make sense to you? I'm looking at you, watching everybody, and wondering.
By all of it. No, I mean, I really liked your question about that. Like, I mean, I feel like I've been reading a lot about, you know, gaming culture as well, and the idea that, you know, people say the same thing about gaming. You know, like, well, you know, they're obsessed with gaming. Is that a bad thing? Is that ruining their brains and so on? And then you realize that the psychology around game addiction has everything to do with how bad their actual reality is. It's not because the game's alluring and the game's wrong. It's because the reality sucks. So, like, suddenly you're like, okay, you know, I don't have a job. My, you know, boyfriend's mad at me. This isn't true. Everything's fine. you know, like it's just bad times or whatever. People resort to games, or someone will resort to a game because they feel like they're accomplishing something and they can get money and they can make friends and all this stuff. And so there's really just an issue with the real stuff that's, you know, making the not so real but maybe should be realer stuff harder for that person to leave. So I think, you know, in the case of, you know, someone who's elderly, who has a robot friend who's taking care of her, the fact that she doesn't have anyone who would take care of her otherwise, I think it, you know, makes it totally okay for that elderly woman to be completely infatuated with her robot friends. Mm-hmm. So I don't know. I find that relationship sort of, you know, kind of what was being said earlier, just the tension between, like, what's real and not real, and maybe there isn't as much of a difference as we think. Mm-hmm.